Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We hope that this worship is a blessing for you along your journey of faith. Each week we try to do something a little different because here at Trinity we have always valued dynamic, relevant, and creative worship. Today, since our readings are all about prayer, we are going to be peppering our worship service with prayers from our members. So, as we begin our worship today, a prayer, a greeting from today's greeters, and then our opening hymn.
Mighty God of mercy, we thank you for our families, our friends, our loved ones, and our church family, and the strength that these bonds give us each and every day. May we always be thankful for these gifts of your gracious love and mercy that leads us during these very uncertain times. Amen.
Hi, good morning. Sorry we can't do this in person, but someday we'll get to be on the other side of those red doors again. Happy Memorial Day weekend, and thanks for joining us here at Trinity.
Hello, this is Marcy. Good morning. Hope you're feeling better. Hope you're safe and sound. Hope to see you here eventually sometime. So have a nice Memorial weekend.
Thank you. Mighty God of mercy, we thank you for the sustaining goodness of your creation. We rejoice in our ability to enjoy the natural wonders of the world and look to find peace within ourselves as we indulge in the earth's beauty. While in the forest beside a quiet stream or on a mountain range overlooking the valley below, your creations are a gift that we must seek to preserve so that generations to come may also receive this blessing. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of glory, your Son, Jesus Christ, suffered for us and ascended to your right hand. Unite us with Christ and each other in suffering and in joy, that all the world may be drawn into your bountiful presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Today's lessons are for the seventh Sunday of Easter. A reading from the first chapter of Acts. When the apostles had come together, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, they were gazing up toward heaven. Suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, toward with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Mighty God of mercy, we thank you for the gifts of relationship with others. We are grateful for new and innovative ways to connect during this pandemic. Thank you for those in our lives who found fun new ways to put a smile on our face during these trying times. Thank you for inspiring us to serve and reach out to others, including neighbors, family, friends, and even strangers. May we continue to strengthen existing bonds and form new relationships that are pleasing to you.
A reading from the fourth chapter of 1 Peter. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he might exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same thing, kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. After Jesus had spoken these words to his disciples, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We gathered today on the Sunday between Ascension and Pentecost. On Thursday, we as the church celebrated Jesus' ascension into heaven. Next Sunday, we as the church will celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. I saw a joke this week on Facebook. For those who wonder what the ascension's about, it's the day Jesus started to work from home. The disciples looked up and saw him zoom. That was originally, by the way, told by a professor from Luther Seminary. And obviously, if there's anything sillier than a dad joke, it's a theology professor joke. But her point is well taken. Jesus is not going to be around in person anymore. He is going to the Father, ascending into heaven. The disciples won't be able to gather with him around the well for a midday chat. They won't go on team-building retreats out on the Sea of Galilee. No more after-work gatherings with drinks and snacks around a table in an upper room. Jesus will still be working, but he'll be working from home. And the disciples will have to figure out how to keep following, keep believing, keep proclaiming without Jesus physically there to urge them on. You know, I'm sitting in my home office right now, working from home, adhering as much as possible to the stay-at-home order that we all pray will end soon because the rates of infection thankfully continue to drop. It has been a change to work at home, to work from home. And behind me, that green thing, that's my daughter's graduation gown. She is set to graduate from high school in a couple of weeks. And it's got me thinking of all of the changes that lie ahead for her and for us. How high school students become workers or college students. How a child becomes a young adult. How she'll eventually move out and begin her own family. As time moves on and circumstances shift, our relationship will change. It has to. The way you relate to an 8-year-old is different than the way you relate to an 18-year-old or to a 28-year-old. But here's the thing. Whether she's 8 or 18 or 28 or 58, she's still going to be our daughter. That won't change. How we connect might change, but the fact that we are connected? Nope. And whether I'm working from my home office or from the church office, I am still the pastor of Trinity, still in relationship with all of you, still leading, still preparing worship, still praying and teaching and pastoring. And yes, how I do those things is different. Absolutely. But whether I'm physically in the same place as you or not, we are still connected as the people of God at Trinity Lutheran Church. Jesus knew that he was going to be working from home real soon as he prayed for his disciples. It's that prayer, or part of it anyway, that we hear in the reading from John today. It's kind of rambly, goes on many more verses than what we read. But it's a son talking to his father, concerned about his disciples, looking for ways to stay connected, even as he knows that the relationship he's had with those disciples is about to change in some pretty enormous ways. And so he prays that as their proximity changes, as the tenor of their relationship changes, that the core of that relationship will remain. He prays for their faith. He prays for their unity. He prays for their protection. It's important, of course, to remember that even as Jesus is praying for his disciples, he's also praying for all of God's children. John gave us Jesus' words way back in chapter 3. For God so loved the world that all may be saved, right? We hear echoes of that in the first part of our reading today, and so we know that Jesus' prayer for his disciples is also his prayer for all of God's children, for the entire world that he has come to save. And even as he knows that he is leaving, first to the cross, and then later, after the resurrection, to ascend to the Father, even as he prepares to leave, Jesus prays for the faith, the unity, and the protection of his followers down through the generations, all the way to us and beyond. There's been a lot of change in the world since Jesus prayed this prayer. In fact, change is one of the consistent truths of human life, isn't it? Growth requires change. Time brings change. We are all maybe all too familiar with change. And we're all familiar with how relationships change. Taking on the care of a parent changes relationships, doesn't it? The one who was once the caretaker becomes the cared for. Or a move, moving across the country or even across the state, no longer being physically close to someone. Well, that changes relationships. Where once you could visit on a whim, be there in person for every birthday or every holiday, now visits are rare and require planning and forethought. Sometimes change makes relationships more difficult, sometimes easier. But change doesn't have to mean the end of the relationship. Jesus talking to his father about continuing the care as the relationships change is a perfect example of that. So what's my point? What's my point for our lives today in 2020? Well, simply that even as life changes, God is still present, listening, caring. And even as life changes, we can still be present for one another. In this time of great change, what an incredibly important reminder for all of us. Like the disciples, we have to figure out how to keep following, keep believing, keep proclaiming, even in the absence of in-person gatherings, even as we go through some pretty enormous changes. Prayer is one of our tools. Just as prayer kept Jesus connected to the Father, prayer keeps us connected to our God and to each other. Prayer reminds us that God is still present in our lives, listening, speaking, encouraging, challenging. Prayer reminds us that we are part of something greater than ourselves, and it keeps us thinking about those with different needs. Prayer urges us to action on behalf of justice for the vulnerable in our community. Prayer teaches us to trust and to wait patiently for what God is about to do, even while reminding us about what God has already done. Throughout this service today, we've included prayers. I didn't write the prayers you hear some of our members praying. They wrote them. These are the prayers of their hearts, the prayers of their faith, prayers that remind them that God is still present and that keep them thinking about the needs and concerns of others. Maybe you have a prayer to pray today, too, a prayer on your heart and mind. Pray it. God is listening. God is present still in your life, right in the middle of all of the changes and challenges you are going through right now. And if your prayer is for others, let that prayer remind you that God is bigger than what you're going through. God is urging you to act for those in need, and God is calling all of us to remember that God has always brought food for the hungry, strength for the weary, and hope for the hopeless, sometimes even through us. Prayer continues the conversation, even as relationships change. Prayer helps us keep following, keep believing, keep proclaiming in the face of change by connecting us to God and to one another. So my friends, my fellow disciples, change is coming. Change is here. It's okay. So is God. Pray. Amen.
Mighty God of mercy, we thank you for family. When we weep, they are there to dry our tears. When we are hurting, they are there to heal. When we are unsure of ourselves, they are there to give us support. When we are lost, they are there to guide us. When we are down, they are there to lift us up. When we are grieving, they are there to console us. When we are overjoyed, they are there to rejoice with us. And no matter whether we are together or not, we know they are always there for us, just as you are, Lord. Amen.
Steady hand, you are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand.
kids. It's Pastor Chapman coming to you from Trinity. I hope that you are well and safe and enjoying your time at home today. I have with me something that I think you're probably pretty familiar with. Do you know what this is? A colored pencil. You're exactly right. This one's green. I like the color green. It's a good color, isn't it? What kinds of things could we draw with a green pencil? Well, you're right, we could draw trees, we could draw grass, we could draw green sheep, we could draw green eggs and ham even, maybe, if you want to go the Dr. Seuss route. What can we draw with a green pencil? Wouldn't it be nicer, though, if we had more than just green? Wouldn't it be nicer if we had other colors, too? So what if we had a red colored pencil? What kinds of things could we draw with a red colored pencil? We could draw fire hydrants. We could draw fire. We could draw a red coat. We could draw all sorts of things, right? We could draw the carpeting I'm sitting on right now. Green and red. We could draw a Christmas picture. Wouldn't it be better, though, even if we had more colors? You know, when we go to draw a picture, it's nice to have lots of different colors that we can use. Here's my jar of colored pencils, and you see I've got all sorts of different colors in this jar. Blues and reds and greens and purples and whites and browns and yellows and all sorts of pink, all sorts of wonderful colors that are part of my pencil jar. When we're trying to draw a picture, it's so much better to have multiple colors, isn't it? To have lots of different colors that we can choose from. Jesus talks today to his disciples, and he's praying for his disciples, actually. And he prays for them to be unified, to be together. What he means is that all of his disciples should be connected to one another. But he doesn't mean that they should all be the same. It's good that we have some differences, right? I mean, all of these are pencils, and they're all colored pencils, but they're all different colors. It's good to have different colors so that we can draw prettier pictures. Here's a picture that I drew recently with all sorts of different colored pencils. It would still be a nice picture if I had only used one color, like purple or yellow or orange. But I think it's better with all the different colors, isn't it? When Jesus prays for us to be unified, he doesn't mean for us all to be the same. He means that we can work together and that we can use our different abilities, our different skills, our individual unique specialness that makes you, you, and use it together to make something beautiful. Being different is good. And working together with other people who are different from us is also good, so that we can make this world a more beautiful place. I hope that you guys have opportunity this week to color a beautiful picture. I'd love to see the pictures that you color. Use as many colors as you can find in your house, as many crayons, as many colored pencils, as many markers. See how beautiful of a picture you can make with all sorts of different colors. And remember that lots of color is a good thing. Be blessed, everyone. Hope to see you real soon. We are blessed here at Trinity to have all sorts of folks who color our congregation in all sorts of different ways, who bring their unique skills and gifts and talents and treasures to make this congregation a beautiful and amazing place. I want to thank you right now for all of the ways that you contribute to making Trinity the best, most wonderful congregation that I know. Thank you for your ongoing support, for your gifts of time and talent and treasure. Thank you for all of the ways that you continue to pray for the ministry of this congregation. We encourage you to bring your gifts, to continue to share your gifts, your treasures, your time, your talent, to share it here at Trinity to support the ongoing work of our congregation. If you are going through hardship right now, we totally understand. But if you can continue to support us financially, we are so appreciative. You can give your gifts online. You can sign up for Simply Giving. You can text your offering. Any of those gifts are so important and valuable in doing this good work. I also want to share the peace with you. The peace of the Lord sustains us and unites us every day. So I share this peace with you, and I encourage you to share it with one another. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share that peace of God.
Merciful God of might, we pray for those in difficult situations. So many have been without work or have lost their jobs. So many are struggling to pay their bills and provide food for themselves and their family. So many are trying to keep a roof over their head and survive during this troubling time. Lord God, turn their despair into hope and touch them with your loving care. Amen.
Seventh Sunday of Easter, we gather in our homes and yet together as one, praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Our response to each petition is, "Your mercy is great." In this time of troubling separation, we pray to you, Triune God, for the unity of your churches. Bind us together in the truth of your gospel. Make us witnesses of your mysterious might. As you blessed the early disciples for their unfolding ministry, bless those who lead and serve our local congregation. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. Nurture the life of your creation. Support those who explore the mysteries of your universe. We praise you for Nicholas Copernicus, whom we commemorate today in the church, and for all the scientists who have enriched our understanding of creation. Help all online teachers to instruct our children in the ways of nature. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. As we prepare for Memorial Day, we pray for peace around the world. Protect all soldiers and assure them of your never-failing strength. Shield the vulnerable who live in paths of violence. We pray especially for the people of Afghanistan, and Syria. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. Come to the aid of all who suffer. We pray for those who are laden with grief, overwhelmed by anxiety, or struggling without medical care. Uphold all healthcare workers who attend to coronavirus patients. Comfort all families and friends who cannot embrace their loved ones in the time of sickness or at the time of death. We give into your care all the sick, especially Carol Dell, Rita Lorenz, John Lauck Sr., Dave Myers, Kevin Jasinski, those with ongoing prayer needs, and those we name before you now. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. Again, we pray, give the world a vaccine. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. To know you, O Lord, is to have eternal life. We praise you for the lives of all who have died in the faith and who now live in you. At the end, bring us with all your saints into your presence. God of unity, hear us. Your mercy is great. With bold confidence in your love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God of our past, our present, and our future, we place all for whom we pray into your circle of love, now and forevermore. Amen. Will you join me in praying the prayer our Lord taught us to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Christ is risen just as he said. Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. We pause now to remember those who have given their lives in service to our country with a prayer and a song.
Heavenly Father, on this Memorial Day weekend, we ask that you remember and help us to remember those who gave their lives in defense of our country. They gave their lives to protect us and to help us gain or maintain our freedom. They made the ultimate sacrifice for our God-given rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We ask your blessing on them and their families. Amen.